Spirit. Brat. You see the problem with that? Because in Hebrew, what gives life, I think, is spirit breath. And I think it's much better to think of the Hebrew word here as spirit breath than either spirit with a capital S and breathing. Just what I need to do to stay alive. What if the work of the Spirit is there in spirit breath? Now I'm going to add a Bible text that is not on your handout, okay? Which is not on your handout. I was thinking about it last night and this morning, and I want to add one text because we are down on number four. We are down on number four. I want to add a text on your handout. Yeah, you see number four on the front, Holy Spirit 101, breathe, number four. I have a bunch of things about Elihu and Daniel. I want to begin that with actually with Job chapter 12, verses 7 to 10. So go to the note. Maybe I should have made these different colors. The very front of this, it says, sorry about this, Grace. Holy Spirit 101, breathe. And if you go to point Roman numeral number 4, Roman numeral number 4, and I want to add Job chapter 12, verses 7 to 10. I want to start with this. I should have put that on the handout, but we're going to start with this. I want to read this with you. Job, of course, is on the ash heap, his life virtually destroyed, no family, but his wife, his children have been destroyed, he's lost his livelihood, and he has no health left. He's scratching himself with broken pots to make the wounds feel better. And he says this, "But ask the animals, and they will teach you, the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Ask the plants of the earth, and they will teach you, and the fish of the sea will declare to you. Who among all these does not know?" Now, who has he just named? He's named who? Who knows this truth we're going to get to in a minute? Who knows this truth? Who? The animals? The plants? The fish? And the birds? Okay, this is something that the animals, the plants, the fish, and the birds know. You ready? "Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this? In God's hand is the life of every living thing and the breath of every human being." Breath. What word do you think is behind that? Sure? Yes. Ruach. The word life there is a word you're probably familiar with. Nefesh, which often gets translated as soul. In Genesis 2:7, Adam coming out of the earth, God breathes into Adam's face, and Adam becomes a living nefesh. But in this case, the second word, the breath of every human being, is ruach. So in God's hand is the nefesh of every living thing and the ruach of every human being. In God's hand is our ruach, our spirit breath. Now, who knows that? The animals know that. The birds know that. The bees know that. The salmon know that. Everybody knows this truth, except human beings. We're busy doing everything in life but attending to this spirit breath in us. I think this is my first breath of the morning, and it's 10 o'clock. I don't think I breathed until now. There is the miracle of breath that the animals and the plants, the spiders, the birds, the fish, they all know it, but not human beings. Do you know the story about the Kalahari Bushmen? Macrina Whitaker, don't change your hand out, I'll just confuse you, but I gave you, I think, on your handout, resources. Don't look. I don't want you to get screwed up with your blue, but you can. It's on the back of the resources handout. Macrina Whitaker. It looks like Weeder Care, but it's actually Whitaker. Macrina Whitaker is a kind of a contemplative Roman Catholic. And she wrote a book called Seven Sacred Pauses. It's how to take a secular day and find the seven pauses of the monastic life in it. It's a really beautiful little book, lots of poetry and things. But she tells the story of the Kalahari Bushmen. There were some Americans who were taking a trip in the Kalahari, and they were businessmen, and they moved at a clip, as you can imagine American businessmen doing. And all of a sudden, the Bushmen who were their guides just sat down on the ground, and nothing the American businessmen could make them they could say, could get the Bushmen to move. And they finally said, what? I'm sure they didn't say it this politely, but what are you doing? And the Bushmen said, we're letting our souls catch up. We're letting our souls catch up. You know, the birds know that, and the fish know that, and the animals know that, even the plants know that. We're the only ones whose souls trail behind our activities. And when we begin to understand that Ruach in the Old Testament is actually spirit breath, in the hand of the Lord is the life of every living thing and the Ruach of every human being, when we begin to capture that, it reshapes how we live. Productivity can mean less. Activity can mean less. The ability simply to breathe can mean something. There are probably some of you here, I've had heart things called atrial flutter and then atrial fibrillation. And when I was just talking to someone at the Houston Medical Center, Houston Methodist Research Institute yesterday. He's a palliative care doctor, a pain doctor, and we're talking about a research project together of bringing doctors to read ancient texts about pain and see what we can learn from each other, what the ancient texts can teach the doctors, what the doctors can tell us about ancient texts. And we were having this conversation, and I was asking him at one point, you know, it used to be when I had atrial flutter before I had the ablation, I would have dreams that I was climbing a mountain or running really and doing something, and then I'd wake up and my heart was out of rhythm. And I said to him, which was it? Did the dream cause the arrhythmia or did the arrhythmia cause the dream? And he said, we don't know. But what I do know is sometimes my life moves faster than the speed of my soul. And my soul can't catch up. And when I realize that Ruach in the Bible that is in God's hand, I can begin to respect the spirit breath that is in me. And even value the miracle of every breath that keeps death at bay and keeps me alive and alert. So let's talk about two ways in the Bible that the spirit breath works. By the way, let's take a minute. Questions of clarification at this point. Yes. Oh, wait. I don't have a microphone for you, so I'll repeat it.
I think Luther and some of the others did the early translations translated from the Vulgate. If they did, that means that they were betrayed with the, I mean, how did they get it remotely right in the Vulgate, which was the standard for, 1500 mm-hmm. years, was completely mistranslated, you know, what now you're saying, yeah. And then it was translated into another language.
Yeah, if the, you're asking a question about the Reformers,
yeah.
And using the Vulgate, which was a Latin translation of the Hebrew and the Greek. Yes. Well, the one in German, they were able to get it right because German Geist does mean breath and spirit, just as it means the atmosphere. You talk in German about the Geist of an age or the Zeitgeist. In the German, Geist has many more meanings, unlike English. So you can put, and of course, in German, Geist, all the nouns are capitalized. So Geist is always capitalized. So whether you're talking about the Holy Spirit or the human spirit or the breath or the spirit of an age, the Zeitgeist, it's always Geist. So it works in German. But they did, Luther did use the Hebrew and the Greek as well. He did use Hebrew and Greek when he translated. So, yes, betraying, yes. Yeah. Multiple betrayals with translation. Of course, that is a very harsh way to talk about translations because it's a very hard task to know how to translate. But in this case, if I had been the translator of these texts, I would have called spirit breath. I would have hyphenated it because I think it's the only way to capture the essence of it rather than choosing. I have a section in a longer book that's not out there. It's like a 500-page academic book where I have a section on translating. And you have, should it be a capital S or a small s? Should it be breath? And I say, all of that really obscures the power of Ruach to be all of the above. Okay, well, I did it with this, and I didn't know how to do it, but you can either do Ruach with a dot under the H. If you put a dot under that H, it makes it a ch. Or you can put a C. So in Fresh Air and in 40 Days, I put a C, R-U-A-C-H. The problem is that people want to translate it as Ruach. Ruach, sort of, you know, like cha-cha-cha. But it's not. So you can either put an H with a dot under it or a C-H, in which case I did neither there. Yes?
When you talk about all of creation understands and we don't, you have a similar thing after the flood. Because God says all creation will understand, all living things will know what the rainbow is. You got the same thing.
Yeah, we have trouble understanding things that more basic elements of creation understand. This is very hard for me at 59. You know, I've moved in my life. You know, I finish an article and there's another article there, or there's a class to teach, or there are papers to grade. So I'm into productivity, and the notion that the spirit breath is in the hand of God and I need to pay attention to that spirit breath is very difficult for me. I'm not a meditator by nature. I'm not a quiet person by nature. But I can learn from that tree out there. I can learn from the squirrel. I can certainly learn from my black lab mix, who doesn't think ahead to the next thing except maybe, are we going to go for a walk? And what's to eat? Yes, absolutely. Okay, so let's move on now to some application of these ideas beyond what we've already said. And what I want to do is I want to compare two biblical figures, Elihu and Daniel, to try to understand how that Ruach, that spirit breath, works in our life. So we're going to go back to the book of Job. Okay, we're back in the book of Job. And in the book of Job, we have, of course, the three older men who come to so-called comfort Job. Actually, Priscilla and I for Lent are reading through the book of Job, you know, 42 chapters in 40 days. Well, since I was at the retreat last weekend and I'm here this weekend, I'm like 7 chapters behind already because I just haven't gotten around to reading my Job chapters. But we're back on this thing, and there's a young man who gets into this maelstrom of conversation about why Job is suffering, and his name is Elihu. We meet him in Job chapter 32, and though he is incredibly misguided, we learn a lot about Ruach from Elihu. So if you go to Job chapter 32, we're going to read through this. Job chapter 32. So these three men, the old guys, ceased to answer Job because he was righteous in his own eyes. Now, a little aside on this, I did get enough into Job for Lent that we got through the beginning, and it's interesting. I've always been pretty hard on the three old guys. I think, come on, don't make Job a case study for why the innocent suffer. Don't do that. It's a very interesting thing, and I think it's in chapter 2. It said, these three men came from far away, and they sat down, and they sat on the ground with Job for 7 days. I could use a friend like that. They sat with Job for 7 days on the ground. And then it says, then Job broke the silence. So they didn't break the silence. They were willing to stay as long as it needed to happen in silence with Job on the ground. But then we get to chapter 7:32, and these men stopped talking because Job was righteous in his own eyes. Then Elihu, son of Barachel the Buzite of the family of Ram, he became angry. He was angry at Job because Job had justified himself rather than God. He was angry also at Job's three friends because they had found no answer, though they had declared Job to be in the wrong. Now Elihu had waited to speak to Job because they were older than he. But when Elihu saw that there was no answer in the mouths of these three men, guess what emotion he experienced? He became angry. Elihu is nothing if not angry. It says it about 3 or 4 times here. He is so angry at everybody. He's like an adolescent who just needs to be angry because the testosterone is pulsing in his body. And he's been quiet way too long. So Elihu, son of Barachel the Buzite, answered, and here he goes, I am young in years, and you are aged. Therefore, I was timid and afraid to declare my opinion to you. I said, let days speak and many years teach wisdom. But truly, it is the spirit in a mortal, the breath of the Almighty that makes for understanding. It is not the old that are wise, nor the aged that understand what is right. Therefore I say, listen to me, let me also declare my opinion. There is an enormous amount of wisdom in what he's saying. First of all, let's unpack the Hebrew words. Verse 8. Truly it is the spirit in a mortal. That is the Hebrew word, ruach. The next word, the breath of the Almighty, is neshama. That's what God breathes into Adam in Genesis 2. Neshama. It means breath. So clearly, ruach and breath in this passage are being identified with each other. So Elihu says, it's the ruach in a mortal, the neshama of the Almighty that makes for understanding. You see that? Very often when we think about the Spirit or the Holy Spirit, we pray for the Spirit to come on us. Next time you're in a church setting or something, notice the prayers that have to do with the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, come to us. Holy Spirit, pour yourself out upon us. Holy Spirit, and it's almost always from the outside in. Come to me, Holy Spirit. Not here in Job 32. In here, the neshama and the ruach are already in us, a gift of the Almighty. And where do we find understanding? Right there. We don't have to go always out there for understanding. We don't have to wait for the preacher. We don't have to go for an experience we've never had for understanding. We don't have to have the Holy Spirit necessarily pour out into us or come to us or approach us. If we are able to attend to the ruach that is in us already by virtue of being created by God, then we can gain wisdom there. The wisdom of being human. You might want to put it this way, created in God's image. That's a much more usual way to put it. How about created with God's ruach? And we attend to that ruach. I think very, very often Christians can make a mistake of thinking that a spiritual experience that happens to us once in a while is more important than the breath we take every moment. If only I could have a better prayer life. If only I could speak in tongues. If only I could. If only the Spirit would speak to me. What if God has already given you Spirit breath? And there is wisdom resident there already. So it's not going out and picking the mushrooms. It's finding what you already have in here by virtue of the ruach of the Almighty in you. Now, I personally think it's both and. But I also personally think that because sort of this 20th century association of the Spirit with things that happen to you, that we've learned to look for the Spirit out there and pray for the Spirit to come in here. But biblically, Ruach is in here, and the Ruach is the source of understanding. That also means the next verse. Notice the next verse. It is not the old that are wise, nor the aged that understand what is right. This means just getting older doesn't make us wiser. We are wise because we attend and pay attention to the Ruach of the Almighty in us. That's what makes it wise. That's where there's a lot of stupid 87-year-olds in the world, and there may be some very wise 23-year-olds. Because sometimes there will be 23-year-olds who are very attentive to the Ruach of God in them, the Spirit breath of God in them. And there are 85-year-olds who've never bothered thinking about the Spirit breath in them. That's why, as well, there may be many people over here who've had a tremendous experience of the Spirit in worship services. But in their daily lives, not so much. Because there's got to be attending to the Spirit breath that's in us. We need to attend to that. The difficulty, of course, is that Elihu thinks this, and he's right, but then he hits Job over the head with a hammer. So he's probably not the one who has this kind of understanding. This is why. Look at verses 16 to 20. Elihu, who we know is extremely angry at Job and at the old guys, Elihu says this in verse 16 of 32. And am I to wait because they don't speak? Because they stand there and answer the more? What, do I have to wait? Wait, wait, wait. Why are you making me wait? I'm going to give my answer too. I'm going to give my opinion. Sick of waiting. For I am full of words. The Ruach within me constrains me. My heart is like wine that has no vent. Like new wineskins, it's ready to burst. I have to speak so that I may find relief. I must open my lips and answer. I'm not going to show partiality to anybody. I'm not going to use flattery with anyone. I have to speak, he says, because the Ruach constrains me. You know what that word constrain is used for elsewhere, that Hebrew word? It's when the Babylonians are coming up against Jerusalem and they build siege works against it in order to knock the walls down. Constrain isn't a polite word. It's not like I am constrained by the situation to use the salad fork. That's not what constrain means. It's used in battle, in war. He says, the Ruach in me is just pushing up against my self-control, and I've waited so long, and I'm so very angry that I have to say this. And I know this when it happens. I've seen it when it happens. I've probably done this myself. Oh, I feel like I just have to say this to you. And somehow you think this is what God wants me to say to you. I am constrained. There are siege works against me, and the Spirit is coming up, and these words are coming out, and they're wise words, he thinks, but they're not at all. So this is another word of caution. The fact that we feel compelled to say something doesn't mean it's the Spirit breath in us. So we have all of these kind of, when the Spirit becomes something in us rather than something that comes to us, though it is both and. When the Spirit is something that comes in the words we speak, we have a particular responsibility to try to determine whether that's just because we're angry or emotional or proprietary about someone else, or in fact, whether it is the Spirit which is speaking in me. That's why when we had our prayer times back at St. Paul School of Theology after the class, it was very clear you never said what came to your mind without sitting on it a very long time and then finally saying, here's what I saw or here's what I heard, and then you say it to them, and then when the prayer time was done, we try to discern whether it was appropriate image or word. Because we know how easy it is to assume that because I have to say it, it might be God. Because I have to do it, it might be the Spirit. But it isn't always. So Elihu gets it right. It isn't age that makes us wise. It isn't an outpouring from the outside that makes us wise. It is a daily attention to the Ruach of the Almighty in us that gives us wisdom. But he's wrong, because eventually the words he says are just angry and uncontrolled, and he beats Job over the head with them. Now, there is another option here. There's another option here. And that comes in the person of Daniel. The person of Daniel. Daniel also has Ruach in him. So let's look at some of the verses for Daniel. Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos. Okay? Sad thing is I have to do that for my students. My future pastors, they have to be told that too. So we have the story of Daniel, very familiar story, lion's den, handwriting on the wall, all this sort of thing, the book of Daniel. And in chapter 4, verses 8 and 9, in the time of Nebuchadnezzar, we'll start at verse 7. The magicians, the enchanters, the Babylonians or Chaldeans, and the diviners came in, and I told them the dream, says Nebuchadnezzar, but they couldn't tell me its interpretation. At last Daniel came in before me, he who was named Belteshazzar after the name of my God, and who's endowed with the spirit of the holy God. Now, in Hebrew, Elohim can be plural or singular. It's a plural word that can be translated plural or singular. Endowed with the spirit of the holy God. And then, of course, because of that, Daniel is able to interpret a dream. Go to verse 18 of the same chapter. This is the dream that I, King Nebuchadnezzar, saw. Now you, Belteshazzar, Daniel, declare the interpretation, since all the wise men of my kingdom are unable to tell me the interpretation. You are able, however, for you are endowed with the spirit of the holy gods. So in chapter 4, you have Nebuchadnezzar acknowledging in Daniel that he has a spirit. This is so hard to translate. It could be the spirit of the holy God, a spirit of a holy God, a spirit of the holy gods. But the one thing we do know, there's Ruach here. Okay, in chapter 4. Now go to chapter 5. And you are a generation later. Chapter 5, a generation later. So we'll go to 10 through 12. The queen, when she had heard the discussion of the king and his lords, came into the banqueting hall, and the queen said, O king, live forever. Don't let your thoughts terrify you or your face grow pale. There is a man in your kingdom who is endowed with the spirit of the holy gods. In the days of your father, Nebuchadnezzar, he was found to have enlightenment, understanding, and wisdom like the wisdom of the gods. Your father, King Nebuchadnezzar, made him chief of the magicians, enchanters, Chaldeans, and diviners because an excellent ruach, knowledge and understanding to interpret dreams, explain riddles, and solve problems were found in this Daniel. Almost makes you out of breath reading the sentence. It's such a long one. Whom the king named Belteshazzar. Now let Daniel be called and he'll give the interpretation. So now Daniel is said to have an excellent ruach in him. A second generation. Go to chapter 6, verse 3. And we'll start with verse 1 in chapter 6. It pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 satraps stationed throughout the whole kingdom, and over them three presidents, including Daniel. To these the satraps gave account so that the king might suffer no loss. Soon Daniel distinguished himself above all the other presidents and satraps because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king planned to appoint him over the whole kingdom. What can we learn from this? Number one, notice that the spirit in Daniel, the ruach, spans three generations. From Nebuchadnezzar to Darius. Sometimes we've been taught that the spirit in the Old Testament comes intermittently and then leaves, comes on someone, then leaves, come on someone, and then leaves. In the New Testament, the Spirit comes permanently. Not true. In the Old Testament, in the Hebrew Bible, and this is actually the Aramaic part, the Spirit, the Ruach, is in Daniel for three generations. He's clearly cultivated and paid attention to this Spirit. And as a result, he can interpret dreams, he can understand visions, he can whatever else he does here. So the first thing we learn is that Daniel is an example of what we read about in Job. In the course of his lifetime, he attends to the ruach that God has given him, and as such, he's called upon to do things that others can't do. It doesn't say, okay, there was a dream to interpret, so the Spirit came upon Daniel and he dreamt it. And then there was a vision to interpret, so the Spirit came upon Daniel and he interpreted it. And there was handwriting on the wall. So the Spirit came upon Daniel and he interpreted it. It doesn't say that. The clear message of this is Daniel had the Spirit for three generations. And it was an excellent spirit. Now the second thing to learn about this is spirit to the nth degree on this handout. Excellent spirit. Terrible translation. You all know what an arm fart is? You used to do this, you know, in the locker room, in the showers. You'd be all wet, and you'd go. Sometimes there are arm fart translations. I used the term at the elders retreat, and then the guy who directed the retreat wrote me yesterday about a text in Luke, and he said, this is an arm fart translation. This is just so bad. So we have here an arm fart translation because excellent sounds so prissy. I went to Cambridge, right? So he had an excellent spirit in him. Yeah, truly excellent. Well done. Pip, pip, old boy. You know? Priscilla used the word brilliant before. That's actually kind of a criticism in Britain, right? It's like the word, oh, terrific in English. It's like, oh, brilliant. I think Keira Knightley uses it in Bended Like Beckham. Oh, brilliant, which means, boy, was that awful. So excellent is just too proper a word. Here's how that word is. It's yatira. And here's where it's used in the book of Daniel. It's used in the book of Daniel where, remember when they get thrown into the fiery furnace? That furnace is so yatira that it burns up the guys who throw them into the furnace. That is so hot. It's not excellent hot, it's super hot. The furnace was so yatira hot that it burned up the guys who were throwing Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into the furnace. Or it's used of Nebuchadnezzar's statue Remember, he builds this huge, tall statue, and everybody has to bow down to it, except Daniel and buddies don't. This huge statue is called Yatira-tall. What do you think that means? Extremely tall. What the word Yatira does, it doesn't mean excellent. It takes whatever is and makes it more. Remember the commercials for, what was it, BAS? We don't make this, we make it better. And in a sense, that's what Yatira is. Yatira is taking something and making it extremely, as much as possible. The statue was as tall as it could be. The furnace was as hot as it could be. Daniel's spirit was as spirit as it could be. There are people like that whose spirits are super saturated with God. Daniel was one of them. That's why he could see things other people missed. That's what we want to be. We want to be known not as people who worship well, not as even people who pray well. Those are all good. But we want to be people who have so attended to the Ruach in us, the Ruach of the Almighty, that we are known as people with supersaturated Ruchot. We are people of spirit breath. And there's something different about us, not from the outside in, but from the inside out. And it's not what you do. It's who you are and the intensity of your hunger for the Spirit. Do you see the difference there? That's what an excellent spirit means. How do we do that before we take our break? It's very simple in the book of Daniel. It's simple. The first thing we do is we eat our veggies. Right? Remember in Sunday school, chapter 1 of Daniel, right? Everybody, all these hunky Hollywood-looking men have been brought to Babylon to be trained so that they can rule over the Israelites for the Babylonians in exile, right? And they're offered steak and wine. They're offered the king's food. And Daniel and his buddies say, no, give us vegetables. Simplicity. I mean, you know this as well as I do. Distractions keep us from attending to the spirit breath in us. The more we're looking out there at things, the less we're looking in here, at the depth of God's breath in us. Secondly, live for the long haul. No shortcuts to spirituality. No shortcuts. Daniel had the spirit for 3 generations. And clearly cultivated its presence in him so that even a pagan leader could say, this guy's got Ruach Elohim in him. This guy's got the Ruach of God, divine Ruach, Yatira Ruach. This guy's got it. I don't know what it is exactly, but he's got it. Living for the long haul. Third way to have this Ruach is don't do a blessed thing. What I remember the day I was studying Daniel, and it was amazing. I was looking at all of these verses together to write on it, and then I noticed there are no verbs. Not a single verb. Not even the verb to be. The Spirit wasn't in Daniel. The Spirit simply in Daniel. Yatira Ruach in Daniel. And it struck me, the Spirit wasn't poured on him. The Spirit didn't rush on him like the judges. The Spirit didn't rest on him like the Messiah in Isaiah 11. Daniel didn't so much seek it or want it or pray for it, the Spirit in Daniel. And I found that profound, that maybe the key to being people who have Yatira Spirit in us, Spirit as Spirit was meant to be, Spirit to the nth degree, maybe we stop all the things we're doing and not simply be, but simply be.